Until Mr. Duncan came to the United States and until the nurses were infected in Spain, it almost didn't seem real to people. But let me tell you, right now the conversation is very dangerous because the only way to stop these cases from coming over is to get a fully adequate response in those three countries. And you know, right now people are saying, well, let's have more checks at the airports. This is like trying to put wet towels under your door when your house is on fire. You've got to put the fire out, and the fire is in these three countries. The only way to stop it is to continue to step up our response and provide humane, effective care and prevent new infections in these three countries.
The head of the CDC today said something that I'd never heard somebody say about this outbreak. He compared it, he said in his experience, it was the closest thing he'd seen was to AIDS. Yeah. Do you agree with him?
Well, in many ways, it's more complicated than AIDS. AIDS is a sexually transmitted infection, so it's actually more difficult to transmit HIV than it is to transmit Ebola. And for AIDS, it was really a matter of identifying the cases and getting them on chronic long-term treatment. Ebola is different. You have to have almost intensive care services available. So it's more complicated, and there's a potential that it'll have an even larger economic impact if we don't get the control on the ground.
Right. You keep talking about this control on the ground and getting into the country. But I need to understand what it is you need to do. Because give me some practical example. I mean, do you want a country to say, fine, we're sending in 5,000 troops that's going to lead the way, that's going to allow a convoy to come in? What is it you need?
Yeah, it's not the troops. The troops can come in and build facilities, and they're doing that, which is great. But what we need is health workers, people who understand, one, how to prevent infection, but two, how to treat people. So let me put you in the mind of a person from Liberia. So let's say you've helped a poor woman. Mr. Duncan's case. The woman was rejected from the hospital. So Mr. Duncan did not know whether or not she had Ebola. But you're a person who thinks, I might have been exposed to Ebola. What's the most rational thing for you to do if you want to live, which is the most important thing, is to get out of Liberia because right now treatment's not available and go to a place that has treatment. So what we need is hospitals that are fully equipped and have great staff coming from both inside, but also we're gonna need a lot of people coming from the developed countries. People who know how to do IV fluids, people who know how to take laboratory tests, people who know how to prevent infections. And we'll need to do a little bit more training of them. But if we get those staff in place, not only in the big cities, but out into the communities, then people will understand that the best chance of survival is to stay in your country because that's where the services are going to be.
The Prime Minister of the Ivory Coast said on my program yesterday, he believes that this crisis will be contained and effectively over by June of next year.
I certainly hope that's the case.
But you don't think it will be?
Well, I'm not sure, and it all depends on whether we get through the current roadblocks. One of them being silly things like hospitals in the United States have not yet stepped up and made commitments of people and resources to help stop the epidemic. You know, there are plenty of workers, health workers in the world. If we could get them to these three countries, it would be stopped. We just got to just every day fight through all the blockages that are preventing that from happening.
When I hear one of the speakers this morning talking about it's time to put together a coalition, it's time to have some meetings to put together a force to move in, too little, too late, and what have you been doing so far, is what to that sort of response.
Well, you know, we're going to have a lot of time to look back, and we're going to have to think about why the response wasn't quicker. One of the things I'm going to talk about at this meeting, Richard, is we have the IMF when there is a financial crisis. Where is that kind of a fund or something that will help us respond immediately to pandemics? We didn't have it. We didn't have billions of dollars available immediately. We didn't have a plan. We didn't have a reserve workforce ready to jump in. We've got to put that together going forward. But right now, there's going to be time to think about that. But right now, we just got to get the systems in place on the ground.
Did you ever think you'd sit in a meeting, and I'm not being facetious when I say this, and have the UN Secretary General say, this is not a time for consultation, and the Managing Director of the IMF say, this is not a time to worry about deficits?
Wasn't that great? These are new developments that came out of the meeting this morning, Richard. Not only do we have medical evacuation, but Christine Lagarde is taking it upon herself to say, you know, we'll live with the fiscal deficits, let's respond. This is great, and you know, that's what gives me hope, that we're now beginning to come together as a global community to fight this together.